Welcome to this lecture that I've titled Sectarian Infighting and the Fall of Jerusalem. This is a lecture for Tisha B'Av, which is the ninth day of the month of Av that we are currently in the Jewish calendar. This is the anniversary of the destruction of the temple in Jerusalem, both under the Romans, which we're going to be looking at in more detail today, and also, ironically, under the Babylonians. It also happens to be a day of tremendous misfortune for Jews. Historically, the Warsaw Ghetto went through its deportations beginning on Tisha B'Av. The Spanish Inquisition and especially the expulsion is associated with Tisha B'Av. And there's so many events in Jewish history that culminate on this particular kind of like national bad luck day for Jews. There's a whole series of quasi-mourning rituals that are observed to mark this dark event, including, for Ashkenazi Jews, weddings are not held for the previous 3 weeks, and for the 9 days coming up to Tisha B'Av, which are called simply the 9 days, Jews don't eat meat, and they don't drink wine, they allow their beards to grow in deeper and all kinds of things like that. So it's definitely a very sad day. And what I'd like to do with our time together today is to look specifically at the epicenter of that sadness, the destruction of the temple itself, and to explore one aspect which is especially highlighted by the rabbis in the Talmud, that of Jewish infighting or sectarian fighting. We will, of course, be looking at other groups besides the standard Pharisaic community. We'll look at the Idumeans, we'll look at the early Christians. I hope to mention the Adiabenians as well. But for the time being, what I'd like to do over the next hour or so is to go through the many different groups that were all competing for control of Jerusalem and the temple in particular, and try, and I hope that we will be able to understand a little bit more of what the rabbis meant when they said that it was baseless hatred that destroyed the temple. So first of all, let's have a look at our sources. Although I've looked at this topic many years in the past, and Tisha B'Av unfortunately happens to be one of the high seasons for my lectures, I went to a different source that I hadn't read in detail before this year to refresh my memory. Emil Schürer, who was a German Protestant theologian, and I was really quite amazed at how good his work was in the 19th century. Even though it's, you would think that something published over 100 years ago would be dated and would suffer from a lot of the disabilities of, new historiographic approaches, his narrative proved to be very fresh and, quite cogent. It was so much so that I read it in an English translation, but his history was actually republished at the end of the 20th century with a new edition with extra footnotes to help us catch up with a lot of scholarship that's happened since then. So I'm going to rely heavily on Emil Schürer's account, and we're going to return to him at the end. We're also looking at modern research. Of course, Steve Mason is perhaps the greatest authority on the destruction of the temple. I've often looked at his major work, The History of the Jewish War, which is a massive tome. It must weigh about 10 pounds, and goes through everything in great detail with a lot of creative new material. But looking at classical sources, we're going to rely, of course, on the Talmud, which is a difficult book to turn to for historical data, primarily because the multiple authors, it is a book that is composed of literally thousands of statements by different people, it's not really intended as a historical source. It does have historical data, but it is primarily a religious source, and more specifically, it has to do with religious law, how ritual conduct should be maintained, which often involves digressions into historical data, scientific data, and so on. So the rabbis nevertheless offer a very compelling position from which to analyze the events of the first century, and it's especially encapsulated in just a few pages in Tractate Gitin. As I mentioned in the introductory comments, they sort of boil down the causes of the destruction of the temples, both the temple that was destroyed in the 6th century by the Babylonians, and then the temple destroyed in the 1st century by the Romans. They sort of boil it down into like really simple, basic ideas that can be carried forward. The first temple was destroyed because three particular sins were violated, and these are, I know the term cardinal sin is really not appropriate for Judaism, but these are the so-called yehareg ve'al ya'avor, meaning a person should rather give up their life than transgress these three sins, which are idolatry, adultery, and murder. A lot more to say about that, but it's beyond the scope of our discussion. And then they said that the second temple was not destroyed for these very serious transgressions, but rather for the idea of sinat chinam, baseless hatred, meaning hating people for no good reason. That level of general hatred is really what brought down the temple, say the rabbis. Now, they don't break it out into the specifics of this person and that person, which I hope to do a little bit today, but they offer an example of a story of two people with very similar names, one named Kamsa and the other one named Son of Kamsa or Bar Kamsa. And I can't go further in this lecture without quickly relating the story, although I'm sure that many of you already heard it. One of them makes a wedding, makes a family simcha or a celebration, and by accident, the other is invited to that simcha. Now, it happens that they are lifelong enemies, and this invitation was a mistake. But the recipient says, oh my gosh, this is so nice. I got an invitation. Maybe they mean to make it up. And he decides to go to the wedding. He shows up at the wedding, and the host sees him there and says, what are you doing here? And he says, what are you talking about? I got an invitation. He says, it's a mistake. I want you to leave right now. And the invitee says, well, wait, don't embarrass me, please. Don't kick me out in front of everyone. Please let me stay. He says, no, not at all. He says, okay, really, I don't want to be embarrassed. Allow me to pay for half the wedding. And he says, I don't care. I need you gone. And he says, I'll pay for the entire wedding. And Kamsa says, no, that's it. Please leave. And so he ends up leaving, but the key point in the story, which is often overlooked, is that the rabbis were all present and they said nothing. They didn't step in. They didn't like suggest that perhaps they should allow him to stay. Look, it was a mistake, but perhaps it's all for the best. Their lack of moral leadership at this particular moment was considered a defining failure that ultimately resulted in the spread of baseless hatred and the destruction of the temple. There are more specifics with regards how the humiliated Bar Kamsa followed up by offering an animal to be sacrificed to the temple and connecting it to Rome. And the rabbis, when confronted with this, I won't go into the technical details, but they failed to find an adequate response to it. And there was one particular individual, Rabbi Zachariah ben Avkolas, who decided that, you know, the rabbis had to be really tied into his specific vision of how the law should be expressed. And rather than make an adaptation because of the unique moment, this ultimately brought about the destruction of the temple by angering Rome. Now, the historicity of all these events is really based totally in the Talmud, but I think we can see that they're definitely echoing things that are marked in other sources. Our major source for today, of course, is going to be none other than Titus Flavius Josephus, known in his day as Yosef ben Matityahu, who is actually a rather brilliant historian. You know, he's a complicated figure. He, as his book called The Jewish War relates, he was a Pharisee who had in his youth experimented with a lot of different religious orientations within Judaism. As we shall see, there are many different expressions of how one might have been a Jew in the first century. He ultimately was assigned the role of being the leader of the rebel forces in the Galilee, where he acquitted himself, at least according to his own count, tremendously well. However, he was captured by Vespasian, a fascinating story about how that happened, the Roman emperor, or the soon-to-be Roman emperor, and he was able to kind of, through his wits, preserve his life and actually attach himself to the Roman forces as a kind of aide-de-camp, kind of advisor, interpreter of sorts. And most famously, after the war, he retired to Rome, where he wrote this phenomenal history of the war and many other books besides. He is, without a doubt, our most detailed source that we will have, but he's a problematic source in many ways. First and foremost, because after all, he was a rebel who then ended up joining the Roman side. And what does that say about his motivation? He was writing under official Roman sponsorship, so would his narrative not be skewed towards his sponsors? We know that he wrote an earlier version of this history, which he wrote in Aramaic, but that version, unfortunately, is lost to history. And so we only have the version that he wrote in Greek, which was the lingua franca of the Eastern Mediterranean. And we have reading Josephus is like a puzzle into itself. But nevertheless, he is actually quite a brilliant historian, compares very favorably with the other great Roman historians of his era. Very compelling writer, fantastic narrative, you know, a sense for the dramatic, as well as a sense for detail. Although sometimes his numbers and things like that are put into question. But that's the primary source that we will be relying on, as any historian would, for a study of this period. Finally, we do have several other accounts that are worthy of note. The great historian Tacitus, who tends to have a rather nasty anti-Jewish position. Cassius Dio, also a very important historian, and Eusebius, an early church historian. You can see, however, though, that with the exception of Tacitus, Cassius Dio and Eusebius are writing quite a bit after the event. Josephus was a participant observer himself, so he was deeply involved in all the events described. Let's start with the war beginning. Now, I really want to focus on the years 69 and 70 in particular, although the genesis of the war can really be traced back much earlier, depending on where you want to start. But I think it's more reasonable to start with the year 66, which is when you begin to have really open hostility that sharply focuses the conflict between Rome and Judea. The local procurator is a name, Mangesius Florus, who was widely regarded as being incredibly culturally insensitive to the specifics of the Jewish population. He had a base on the coast. There was a much more Roman-flavored city called Caesarea, or Caesari in Hebrew, that was actually built by Herod or significantly renovated by Herod. And from there, he would, you know, issue various proclamations and decrees that deeply offended the Jewish sensibilities, particularly in Jerusalem, where they were, for example, very much opposed to the setting up of images like Roman standards and things like that. But Gessius Florus really could not care less. And several other incidents where the Jews felt that Gessius Florus really did not have their best interests at heart. There was numerous armed conflicts, especially between the region of Galilee in the north, and then increasingly in Jerusalem, where there was conflict with Gessius Florus's actual soldiers in the streets. The way things worked out over the year 66, the Romans decided to send in a legion of soldiers from the north under the rule of Cestius Gallus. And he marched down. He actually set up shop outside Jerusalem, and he could have put it under siege or attacked it for reasons which seem unclear. He decided that perhaps his presence there had made a statement that Rome always had legions nearby, and he decided to retreat. And on his, which really I don't think was seen as a retreat, really real troop movements at the time. But on the way back, he was ambushed very cleverly by the zealots led by Elazar ben Shimon and Shimon bar Giora in particular, who attacked his baggage train and actually destroyed it. And Cestius Gallus, although he survived and managed to make his way back to Rome very briefly before he passed away, it was a humiliating defeat that these ragtag bands of zealots, of rebels, who were not representing any official faction other than, you know, kind of like being hooligans at the time, they nevertheless were able to defeat a Roman legion at this pass shown in the image, the pass of Beit Horon. This obviously got Rome's attention, and they decided to take still more stringent measures, and they would ultimately send in Vespasian. Meanwhile, in Jerusalem, as the conflict with Gessius Florus is escalating and Cestius Gallus is sent packing, there's more radical activity. An individual named Menachem attacked the Roman base at Masada, and he seizes all of their weaponry, which is a really amazing thing as well. And then he went to Jerusalem, and there he actually murdered Ananias, a high priest, which was tremendously scandalous thing to do. And there were some significant uprisings between the general population, who, although they may not have agreed with what the high priest had to say and his policies in general, they certainly weren't in favor of having these outsiders come in from the Judean desert and take over the city. One of the things that happened early on is that they burned down the place where all the local records for debts were held. And this indicates to some analysts that there were strong socioeconomic elements to the early conflict, that they wanted to remove all of the records of who owed money to whom so that they could be, they receive large debt amnesty. Ananias's son, named Elazar, goes and murders Menachem, who had murdered Elazar's father. And with the end of Ananias, there was basically an end to the pro-Roman posture in Jerusalem, and things just spiraled further and further out of control, as we shall see. Rome sends in a great general, Vespasian, one of the most talented generals, to essentially restore the honor of Rome after Cestius Gallus had lost it when he was attacked by Shimon bar Giora and Elazar. And he comes in from the north, and he takes his time. He arrives in the year 68, if I remember correctly, and he spends 2 years just essentially engaged in much smaller mop-up activities in the north, wandering down to the center of the country. He has plenty of time to besiege Jerusalem, but he ultimately decides not to do it for reasons that we shall discuss shortly. But more significantly, when the emperor Nero takes his own life, Vespasian is shortly called back to Rome, where he ultimately becomes the emperor. And the person who takes over after him is his son Titus, who is shown here in his battle garb. I believe the individual at the bottom is Vespasian. I'm not sure, but the larger image shows that in this particular triumph, he is celebrating the destruction of Jerusalem. You can see at the top, the menorah is proudly displayed there as well. This may be the triumph in Rome that occurred after the battles were all over. Now, looking at the main point that we want to get to today is to understand who is fighting whom. We've already seen some of the zealots, but let's go through the many different groups. This is going to be a bit of a blur, and it is rather confusing to try to keep track of them, but I'll try and keep us focused on the main groups. The first and the dominant group were the so-called Herodians, so-called because they were descended from King Herod, who had passed away at the end of the first century before the Common Era. His great-grandson was king at the time. He's shown on the left here, King Agrippus II, also pronounced Agrippa. He's an unusual character. Like his predecessors, they had no real power, and Roman authorities, immediately after the death of Herod, had simply kept on the Jews as kind of puppets or as client kings from time to time, actually not even giving them control of Judea itself or giving them very limited control. Agrippus was in this family. He was not considered a great leader at all, and he had very little authority vis-a-vis the Romans, but he did believe that the ongoing alliance with Rome was appropriate for Judea. Rome was such a you know, an overwhelming world power, and Judea was this tiny little nation. The concept of rebelling against overpowering Rome was anathema to Agrippa, and he made some strong speeches recorded in Josephus, I'm sure, you know, embellished with his creative artistry, but he made some strong speeches for a kind of pro-Roman orientation. Let's stop all of this rebellious activity. It's getting out of hand, attacking a Roman legion like that. How are we going to patch this together? This particular image shows some of the key players at the time, besides Agrippa's the second, who was shown on the left looking kind of like an Oriental king. You have Festus, who is the Roman proconsul. His name means like happy, but he certainly doesn't look so happy. And Agrippa's sister Berenice, who had actually a romantic relationship with Titus that was quite celebrated in the ancient world. And this is a moment which is recorded in the Gospels where Paul presents some small version of his views of Christianity and Judaism to Agrippa, simply because Agrippa is curious and he wants to know more about Christianity, which is emerging at this time, and we will return to them. So you have this party of, we can call them Herodians, who are essentially the old aristocracy, who have connections to Rome and want to see that connection maintained and preserved. Not necessarily because they totally capitulate to everything that Rome wants. Berenice in particular was frequently trying to hold off some of the more negative aspects of Roman policy in Judea, but nevertheless, they want to maintain at least the traditional alliance that they've had for, you know, nearly 200 years now. Then you have the so-called Sadducees, in Hebrew the Tzedukim. The Sadducees are especially associated with the temple cult. And at this point, just like the kings of Judea were essentially puppets to Rome, the high priest was also a formality that was assigned by Roman sponsorship. And the high priesthood simply was, you know, a churning kind of revolving door occupation where, you know, you would have them replace sometimes several in 1 year. It was a tremendous turnover of these high priests. It was a very high status position, obviously, but was one that was essentially corrupted by the rule of the Herodians and by Roman influence. They often engaged in high levels of ideological conflict with the Pharisees. In the Talmud, they have lots of debates in which the Sadducees are invariably portrayed in a very negative light. But like the Herodians, they want to go back to the status quo ante. They want to go back to the idea of Rome in control and Judea being, you know, loyal subjects of the empire. They will have an especially difficult time with the so-called Sicarii, or the short knives, daggers. That's what they were named for. These were the individuals who carried these short knives while wearing regular plain clothes, as Josephus describes it, and they will infiltrate crowds and actually assassinate people that they view as their opponents, as people who are associated with the regime. Menachem, who we saw earlier, who murdered Ananias, the high priest at the time, and Elazar ben Shimon is another of these zealot forces who are especially feared by the Sadducees because they're in there and they're trying to take over the old aristocracy, perhaps for many of the socioeconomic reasons that we described earlier. On the other side of the ideological coin from the Sadducees is, of course, the Pharisees. And I use this particular 19th century image to illustrate them because the Pharisees are generally regarded as the progenitors of the later rabbis. The rabbinic movement comes from the Pharisees. The term Pharisee is sometimes mentioned in a derogatory sense, perhaps derived from particular readings of the Gospels in which Pharisees are often in dispute or in debate with Jesus. But it is basically a translation of the Hebrew term perushim, meaning those who separate. Separating in the sense that they separated from official authority, from the Herodian aristocracy, from the Romans, and so on. Josephus takes pains to note that the Pharisees are, by and large, the most popular party, that they have the support of most of the countryside, who are alienated by the violence of the zealots, and they despair of any effective leadership from the Herodians. So the Pharisees are kind of like the natural leadership of the broader masses, but they have no other official power base other than their sort of charismatic spiritual leadership. They are at this time in an uneasy alliance, however, with what some scholars call the Peace Party. And the Peace Party basically includes the Herodians and the Sadducees. The Sadducees are, you know, the ideological enemies of the Pharisees. The Sadducees, for example, deny the existence of an afterlife, something which is very core to Pharisaic theology. The Pharisees and the Sadducees are unhappy about how the Pharisees have popular power, but the Sadducees control the temple culture and so on. So it's surprising to see them in an alliance, but what they all agree on is that the level of communal violence that has penetrated Jerusalem is getting out of hand, and they have to find a way to scale it back, even if that means putting up with Roman domination. The most important leader of the Pharisees for our purposes is undoubtedly Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, who in a very dramatic passage, which is echoed in Josephus, but with different players, Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai manages to fool the zealots, who are called Biryonim in the text of the Talmud that describes this passage. He manages to fool them into allowing him to leave Jerusalem and actually speak and negotiate with the Roman authorities. And he does so by faking his own death and pretending to be a coffin in a corpse. The zealots actually don't believe it at first, and they ram iron rods through the coffin to be sure that he is in fact dead. He miraculously survives that. He's taken outside of the walls of Jerusalem, where he meets with Vespasian and tells him that he will one day be emperor. And Vespasian, you know, impressed with this prophetic statement. Again, this passage is mentioned in Josephus as well, although Josephus is the hero there, and it happens in the north, not in the south. But Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai says, okay, I want three things. The one that's especially important for us is, he says, give me Yavne and its sages, meaning let me have the city of Yavne, which is, at the time, it was called Yamnia. You can see it here in this map. It's a short distance from Jerusalem on the coast, and allow the rabbinic tradition to continue there by allowing safe passage of rabbis to Yamnia, or allow them to collect there and not be massacred by the Romans. And that, in fact, is the decision that allows rabbinic Judaism to continue, because they have some safe space in Yamnia. In this context, I want to take us to another group that's very significant that also adopts a similar posture, and that is the Christians. Now, the Christian movement at this point is still very, very young. We're talking about 30 years after the crucifixion. And so there, who knows how many hundreds of people, perhaps thousands, but that seems like a stretch. But it's definitely a small number, primarily of Jews who are impressed with the teachings of Jesus of Nazareth and believe that a version of Judaism that is described by Paul in particular is really the route to future salvation. It's kind of at this time very much an amalgam of Judaism and what would become Christianity, because the two movements have not formally separated at this point. They definitely are up until this point, they have been praying in the same spaces, observing the same ritual calendar, regarding as holy many of the same teachings. But over the century after the crucifixion in particular, there will be a widening gap that separates the early Jewish Christian movement from the original Jewish movement. It will be exacerbated by the large inclusion of non-ethnic Jews in early Christianity. As Christianity becomes much more Gentile in ethnic composition, there's much more of a reduced tendency to view the Jewish origins of the movement with the same level of charity. And but that's more for another discussion than today. What happened to those Jewish Christians during the time of the revolt? The truth is, Josephus tells us nothing about them, probably because they are really small in size. He will have some passing comments on Christianity in another book that he would write later called The Antiquities, but he doesn't really tell us much about what was going on with the Christians at this time. Much more significant passage occurs in Eusebius's massive church history, which was written about 200 years later. And he writes in his introduction, for example, that his book is going to be a history book that focuses primarily on things that immediately overtook the whole ethnos because of their plot against our Savior. Now, it's clear from that passage that Eusebius has a particular theological interpretation of the destruction of the Second Temple that is essentially blaming the Jews and their downfall because of how they treated Jesus. This is not an argument that appears in Josephus, but it will appear significantly over many other theological approaches in coming centuries. At any rate, let's answer the simple question, where were the Christians? According to Eusebius, he writes that the people of the church in Jerusalem had received some kind of a prophecy given by an oracle before the war, saying that you should all leave, that it's going to be dangerous and they should flee. The oracle revealed that they should flee to a place called Pella, which was either in the Perea, that's the phrase that Eusebius leaves, and I'll show you a map in just a second, but according to other historians, it was in the Decapolis, just on the other side of the Jordan River. And they believe that this is where Christianity would be preserved during the war. Here's the map that shows you Jerusalem in the south, and here is Pella, which is clearly in the Decapolis, so there are some questions about the text itself, but nevertheless, that's what's happened to the Christians. They apparently have no role in the story that we are going to describe. Okay, now we should turn to some of the named zealots who are very active and fighting, as we shall see, with the Herodians, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and most significantly, with each other. John of Giscala is one of the most significant figures. Giscala is an interesting place. It's in Hebrew, Gush Chalav, which means like, you know, very productive milk, which is a place in the Galilee region. He was originally a moderate who was apparently alienated by the Romans and their cruel policies, but he was a longtime enemy of Josephus. Josephus has nothing nice to say about John of Giscala. In fact, views him as a prime instigator for some of the worst violence, both in the north and especially in Jerusalem. So again, Josephus is such a tremendous treasure as a historical source, but a very difficult treasure to work with because it's hard sometimes to parse what actually happened when you're trying to filter it by what we know about Josephus's personal attitudes. At any rate, he escapes Vespasian when Vespasian is still in the north, and he enters Jerusalem in 68. And it's at this time then that John of Giscala would portray himself as an ally to the high priest Ananus, not the same person that was murdered earlier, Ananias, but he would ultimately also be murdered by the zealots. Josephus portrays John of Giscala as kind of like pretending to be allied with the Herodians and the Pharisees and Sadducees, the peace party, but in reality feeding information to the zealots so that they can be more effective in their attempt to take over the city. He ultimately is successful in taking over a large band of followers of Elazar ben Shimon, so his forces grow very large. And also, we should remember at this time that there's different populations entering Jerusalem. Not only do pilgrims arrive in Jerusalem in large numbers for the holiday of Pesach, for example, and the holiday of Sukkot. Josephus describes this in some detail. But also there are war refugees because there's the Roman incursion to the north and chaos going on there. And in the south, you have these zealots wandering around and people are fleeing their homes, looking to the big cities, hoping to find some safety. But John of Giscala ultimately will execute his erstwhile allies, the Herodian aristocracy, and will ultimately be the person in charge of the temple courtyard. And he will invite Yochanan ben Tzvi, who's just another one of these bandit leaders, who takes pride in personally murdering the Herodians that he comes across. And these, by the way, of course, are all Jews. This is entirely Jewish infighting that we're discussing at this point. And now, to understand how this unfolds, we really have to see a little bit of the map of Jerusalem itself to understand where these various forces were gathered. So here's an aerial view of the city of Jerusalem as it appeared in the first century. And you can see the kind of wavy, squiggly lines are topographic in nature, meaning the when they are closer together, like in the Kidron Valley, which is in the lower right corner, that means a much steeper incline. And when they are further apart, it means more of a plateau. So Jerusalem is built on several of these plateaus, and there are some significant geographic separations by the valleys that are in there. So we're going to look at the Temple Mount, which is located here on this particular plateau. We're also going to look at this tower called the Antonia Tower, which is the most significant military fortification of the temple grounds itself. It was actually home to a contingent of soldiers at several points in the war, and it is the base from which most of the military activity would ensue. We also have this region called the Lower City, and of course this higher class area called the Upper City, where Herod had actually built his own palace. There are also several walls around Jerusalem. There is the so-called First Wall, which is kind of an extension of the wall surrounding the Temple Mount itself that encapsulates the Upper City and the Lower City, and so it's sort of like a larger expression of the Temple Mount wall itself. And then a second wall was built that protects the Antonia and reinforces some of the northern suburbs. And finally, especially as the population of Jerusalem would grow, a third wall was built to the far outside. And in fact, that would be penetrated very early on by the Romans. And so now that we have a little bit of geography, we're going to return to some of the major players. The high priests and the Pharisees, again, this is one of those, this is the peace party, this is the unusual, you know, coming together of ideological enemies saying, you know, we may disagree about a lot of things, but we certainly can't have fighting in the streets. They call upon the larger population to repudiate the zealots who are actually engaged in, you know, wide-scale massacres at this point. The zealots end up taking over the temple ground, where they become trapped because they can't get out of the multiple walls, and this is their only base for self-defense. They do manage to sneak out a messenger, however, who goes to the south to the Idumeans, which is an interesting population, and asks the Idumeans for support, claiming that they have been oppressed, like the Idumeans, by the aristocracy, by the Herodians, and would they please send troops to rescue them in Jerusalem. Now, Idumea is here in the south of Israel. It's an unusual part of Jewish history because this is the only time when Israel engaged in any form of forced conversion. And in fact, after the Idumean incident, it was decided to never again engage in forced conversion. This is something that occurred under one of the Maccabean kings, the Hasmoneans, and among the many negative results of this was the birth of Herod, whose father was an Idumean. And so it's widely regarded in rabbinic thought that the whole idea of forcibly converting any population to Judaism was just a bad one to start with, and Herod was in many ways the punishment that the Jews received for it. At any rate, you have this population in the south that identifies as Jewish, but recognizes their distinctiveness from the Judeans per se. There are lots of interesting discussions about patrilineal descent and matrilineal descent in this context, but again, not for this short presentation. And the Idumeans find themselves taken in by the argument that the Zealots offer, that they're being persecuted by the aristocracy. The Idumeans also have a kind of a feeling that they're often looked down upon and are persecuted, so they send 20,000 soldiers to rescue the Zealots in Jerusalem. These numbers that Josephus offers have often been challenged, and we have to take them with a grain of salt, but even if it's a significant fraction of 20,000, it's still going to be a lot of people. When they get to Jerusalem, they are held off by the city walls, and the high priest Ananus comes out and says, "Hey, you know, please understand what's going on here." And he makes an impassioned speech saying, "We are not, you know, oppressing the Zealots. They've come in here, they've committed violence, and this is not good for us if the Romans see us all fighting with each other. It's just going to weaken our movement." And he tries very with tremendous effort to keep the Idumeans out of the city. He is unfortunately unsuccessful, because one of the Zealots slips out of the city once again and actually opens up the city gates for the Idumeans. And this is when the violence just gets much, much worse. The Idumeans enter, and together with the Zealots, they massacre the high priest Ananus. And this actually happened on the temple grounds. Josephus considers this the point of no return for Jerusalem, meaning before the Idumeans and the Zealots murdered the Kohen Gadol, Josephus felt that maybe the Judeans could patch it up with the Romans, saying, "Sorry about those Zealots, sorry that we couldn't, you know, keep them from destroying Cestius's Gallus's legion and things like that. Really, we didn't mean those things." But once the high priest Ananus was murdered, the population would descend into a whirlpool of violence, and there will be no one left to adequately defend the Jewish cause in front of the Romans, and he felt that at that point, really, Judea was doomed. The violence extended beyond the attacks on Herodians, but it went into the civilian areas as well. The local defenses of Jerusalem, the civilian militia, was attacked by and overwhelmed by the Idumeans, and also door-to-door attacks on the general population happened at this point, where, you know, the Idumeans and the Zealots would simply run amok and raping and killing and as they went. To give one example of the level of lawlessness, the Zealots wanted to put a particular prominent individual named Zacharias on trial, and they convened a Sanhedrin, a grand jury of 71 members, to convict him of the crimes they accused him of. But the Sanhedrin did not want to go along with this, and so instead the Zealots simply slit his throat and threw his body into the valley over the city wall. Just a kind of extreme lawlessness going on at this time. And then finally, it gets so bad that even the Idumeans regret their role, and they say, "You know, wait a minute, we came here because, you know, we thought you were being oppressed, but now we see that you are the oppressors," and they decide to leave. They leave in disgust. Before they leave, they release all of the prisoners, and many of them end up going to join another one of the Zealots, Shimon bar Gioria, who was also active at this time. This particular coin shows possibly Shimon ben Gioria led off in chains by Vespasian. You can see on the right there is a prisoner there, and some numismatic experts have associated with him. He plays a very important role in the eventual triumph in Rome. Up until this time, he has not been in Jerusalem. He has been ravaging the countryside. And like, you know, there's general lawlessness that has spilled way beyond the city of Jerusalem and way beyond the Galilee region. There's this widespread hooliganism and highway robbery, literally, and people are being killed, not only the regular Jews of Judea, but the Idumeans as well. Incredible savagery associated with Shimon bar Giora, regularly amputating limbs from his prisoners, and quite often just mutilating them and sending them back to send a message to prevent any further resistance to his movement. The zealots are actually afraid of him. The zealots in Jerusalem, they actually try to threaten him into submission by kidnapping his wife. Remember, these are all, you know, Jews fighting each other and criminal Jews fighting each other at this time. And the Herodians are largely displaced. The Pharisees have decamped. The Christians have decamped at this point. But when they kidnap his wife, he actually comes up to the walls of the city of Jerusalem and puts on such a tantrum that the zealots are actually afraid of him standing outside the walls yelling at them. And they release his wife, hoping that perhaps he won't be mad after all. He ends up being part of the invasion of Jerusalem in the spring of 69, along with the Idumeans, and he ends up dominating the lower and the upper cities with them. Here is the map of Jerusalem again, and you can see that the forces are arrayed in three major areas. Elazar ben Shimon, one of the early zealots we spoke about, is actually in the temple itself. John of Giscala is controlling the temple courtyard, and there are like rings of walls that protect them from each other. And Shimon bar Giora is controlling most of the upper and lower cities where most of the people of Jerusalem live. And it's a three-way fight between these three zealot forces. The Herodians are sidelined at this point, and they're simply waiting for the Romans to come in. Let's understand what happens in the context of the battle now. So the fight becomes so intense between these three zealot forces that they actually attack each other's stores of grain and burn them, hoping that they will weaken each other by preventing them access to foodstuffs. And this was such an incredibly stupid and short-sighted strategy, because the Romans are going to use hunger as their primary weapon. But by destroying the grain storage of each of their opponents, they have no way to withstand the ultimate attack of Vespasian, and especially Titus, who will be very much involved at this point. Vespasian has actually gone back to Rome by now, but Titus is following the same strategy, taking his time, making forays around the north central part of Israel, down into the south of Israel, but he won't attack Jerusalem until he is completely ready. And that's essentially what happens beginning in the spring of the year 70. And this map illustrates what is going on. The famine has already been a serious problem when Titus approaches Jerusalem. And Titus thinks that he's going to have a fairly easy time attacking Jerusalem, but he's actually quite surprised because the rebels provide unusually stiff resistance. Even though they're busy fighting each other, they end up becoming quite ferocious fighters against the Romans at the same time. A couple of key examples include that, you know, the Romans settled in on one of the surrounding hills nearby, Mount Scopus and also the Mount of Olives, and they get themselves set because they're going to be building their siege engines and things like that. The rebels surprise them by pouring out of the city of Jerusalem and actually attacking uphill at tremendous disadvantage to themselves. And they actually manage to make tremendous progress. Titus himself is wounded in one of these attacks until they finally are able to push the rebels back into the city. And they very narrowly evade destruction by this bold and rather unusual attack. Another example, the Romans, you know, their way of destroying the city is going to be with lots of people and technology, specifically the building of siege engines, which are these massive towers that they can wheel up to the walls, and then they can throw things over with catapults and they can climb over the walls with them. But it takes time to build these things, and there are certain places where they are, you know, most ideally situated. So while they're busy building these things, the rebels actually dig underneath the ramps that they intend to use for the siege engines, and they build a tunnel underneath. They fill it with wood, and when the Romans place their laborious product of their work, the siege engine, in place, the rebels set fire to the wood in the tunnels, collapsing the tunnels and destroying the siege engine. And this is like hugely frustrating to Titus, because, you know, this is schlepping out, so to speak. The war is going on much longer, and it's actually embarrassing to the Romans that the Jews should be having such success. Josephus puts it very well when he says that the Romans held it to be terribly disgraceful if cunning should always prevail over valor, desperation over weapons, mass over expertise, Judeans over Romans. But in fact, that's what is happening in the early months of Titus's siege, that they are able to hold them off with the combination of cunning, desperation, mass, and being Judean, I guess. The last decision that Titus makes, therefore, is he says, you know what, we're just going to use the old-fashioned route, and we are going to starve them into submission. And he builds this massive siege dike, you can see, functionally the fourth wall around Jerusalem, and he mans it very carefully to make sure that no food can be smuggled into Jerusalem from the surrounding countryside. He shuts down any possibility for Jerusalem to get any provisions from the outside. When you combine that with the fact that the zealots have already destroyed their own grain stores, they descend into a horrible level of famine, which Josephus describes in very pathetic terms, involving human cannibalism and the same kind of terrible things that ironically are also described in the book of Jeremiah and in the book of Lamentations and the destruction of the first temple. In the end, Jerusalem is doomed, and it will fall to Titus's sieges. The story behind it, however, is somewhat complex. Josephus says that Titus holds a war council and says that he wants to burn out the temple complex and take care of the last rebels, but he wants to actually preserve the temple itself. Now, it's possible that Josephus places Titus in a very positive light here, because Josephus is, of course, sponsored by Titus. He, in fact, ends up being assigned the Flavian name because of his close relationship to the Roman emperor family. But it's also possible that Titus wanted to preserve the temple because, after all, it was like one of the great wonders of the world. It was one of the most fascinating and well-known architectural feats, renovated significantly under Herod and attracting thousands upon thousands of pilgrims from all around the Middle East, Jews and non-Jews as well. So we don't really know how true this is, but it's not impossible to imagine that Titus did not actually want to destroy the temple itself. He wanted to destroy the rebellion, and he may have rededicated the temple to Jupiter or something like that, like Antiochus did when the Greeks conquered the region. But this is, at any rate, the account that Josephus gives us. Now, the rebels, in the context of this fighting, which we've discussed in a little bit more detail in a previous lecture, they rush out to engage the Romans. And in that context, according to Josephus, one of the rebels grabbed a piece of burning wood and threw it through a window into the inner sanctuary. And that was actually the spark that ignited the burning of the temple itself, which continued from the 9th of Av well into the 10th of Av, and is, of course, the reason for the commemoration on this day, the 9th of Av. So if we can conclude, let's just go back to Emil Schürer for a minute, that we looked at him at the very beginning. And I remember reading, it was so fascinating to see his account of the destruction of Jerusalem, viewed from the lens of a Protestant theologian from Germany in the 19th century. And he concluded by saying this: A Jewish authority in the earlier sense no longer existed, meaning with the destruction of the temple, the ending of the sacrifice that actually occurred a few weeks earlier on the 17th of Tammuz. What the Jews knew about how they were to relate to God in a physical way no longer existed. Authority itself had disappeared. The only center left to the people was the Torah. They now rallied around it with anxious and scrupulous fidelity, in the unwavering hope that it might once again, in a political community, and indeed in the world itself, acquire practical validity and use. Fascinating way to conclude his discussion of the temple. And hopefully this will be the last ninth of Av that we have to commemorate together, and that the next time will be a celebration in a rebuilt Jerusalem. Thank you very much for your attention. And I hope if for those of you who are fasting, you conclude the fast well. And thank you.